Learning objective. At the end of the lecture, you all must be able to discuss the principles of the classification of bacteria. You must be able to classify the bacteria on the basis of different things like nature of cell wall, staining procedures like Gram staining, and morphology of the organisms, nutritional requirements of organisms, and their ability to form spores. And you must be able to discuss the concepts in the microbiota of various areas of the body. Bacterial classification. Bacteria have been classified and identified to distinguish one organism from another organism and also to group the similar bacteria according to the criteria of interest of microbiologists or any other scientist. Principles of the bacterial classification. Actually, first principle of classifying the bacteria is that there must be some reason for making the classification, which then follows there can be several classifications of the same organism or object, each scheme being created for the particular reason. So, classification, whenever it's done, the main principle is that it must be done for a reason. Whenever there's a goal, the reason, then we will classify. And there must be some criteria on the basis of which we are going to classify the bacteria or any other object. Classification of bacteria. It includes kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. For the bacteria, we mostly use genus and species criteria. So when we name the bacteria, first we write the genus, and which starts with the capital alphabet, and then we write the species name, and that always starts with the smaller alphabet. For example, Escherichia coli. Escherichia is a genus, and which is actually behind the name of the person who discovered it. It has been named accordingly. So names are mostly memorizing the person who has discovered or who has done some work on the dead bacteria. While species here is the coli, which is always written with the small alphabet. Bagge's manual for classifying and identifying the prokaryotes, also known as bacteria. Bagge's manual of determinative bacteriology provides identification scheme for identifying bacteria on the basis of morphology, differential staining procedures, and the biochemical reactions. While the Bagge's manual of systematic bacteriology provides phylogenetic information on bacteria on the basis of ribosomal RNA sequencing. Initially, the bacteria was classified on the basis of nature of the cell wall, and they have divided into different groups. While now, by using the criteria of the base sequence of the DNA, some of the bacteria have been reclassified and they have been renamed. For example, Pseudomonas sepecia now have been named as Burkholderia sepecia, as it has been found that there are differences in their characteristics from the characteristics of the other bacteria which are in the same group. So now it has been reclassified. Macroscopic appearance, classification of the bacteria according to the nature of cell wall. First group is that having rigid thick walled cell, which is again subdivided into two major groups, free living extracellular bacteria, which can live without the help of any other living organism like animal or the human being, while other group is the non free living. They are obligate intracellular parasites. They need actually host cell for their multiplication, for their survival. So they are known as obligate that parasite. Second group is a flexible thin walled cells containing group, for example spirochetes. Third group is that which is having one genus, that is the mycoplasma. Actually they are wall-less cells and they have steroid in their cell membrane, but they do not contain peptidoglycan and other things that are unlike to the other bacteria. So you can see the classification on the basis of the nature of cell wall. Rigid thick wall cells have been classified into free living and the non-free living organisms. Free living again have been divided on the basis of the gram staining procedure into gram positive and the gram negative bacteria. Gram positive have been subclassified into the cocci, that is spherical shaped bacteria. On the basis of the shape under microscope, they have been classified into the two main groups, cocci and bacilli. Cocci are spherical shaped and it includes the streptococcus family and also the streptococcus. While other are the rods, bacilli. They have been again classified into the further subgroups. Number one is the spore-forming rod, other is the non-spore-forming rod on the basis of the ability to produce and form the spores, which are of the two types, endogenous and the exogenous. The endospores and endogenous and the exospores. They are also subdivided on the basis of their oxygen requirement. First group is aerobic, which is consisting of one single genus, Clostridia bacillus. With there are two species of the bacillus, Bacillus anthracis and the Bacillus cereus. Other group is the anaerobic, spore-forming rod, which again consists of only one genus, that is the Clostridium. There are different species of the Clostridium also, Clostridium tetanus, Clostridium perfringens, Clostridium botulinum. So, there are two main groups of the spore-forming rod, aerobic and the anaerobic, having single genus each of them. Other group is the non-spore-forming rod. It is divided into the two subgroups, non-filamentous and the filamentous. Filamentous consisting of Cornibacterium, Listeria, and filamentous consists of Actinomyces and the Nocardia. Gram-negative again have been divided into the cocci and the rods. There are only one important human pathogenic cocci, which is consisting of two bacteria. This Listeria genus is consisting of Listeria gonococcus and the Listeria meningococcus. While gram-negative rods have been divided into the multiple subgroups. Number one, facultative anaerobes. Number two, stick aerobes. Number three is the stick or obligate aerobes. Facultative group includes three subtypes. They can more depending on the actually where they are actually affecting, which part of the body they are using to cause the pathogenesis. First group is the facultative rods, that are straight rods. Respiratory organisms, zoonotic organisms, and enteric and related organisms are included in this group. Then there is the curved rod, which includes the Campylobacter, Helicobacter, and the Vibrio. So, the facultative anaerobes are subdivided into the to lose the state and the curved round. Well, then there will be a second group aerobic, which are actually obligate aerobic bacteria. What are those? Pseudomonas. Most are the main organs of this group. Then there will be anaerobic, and it consists of bacteroids. Then there is a third group, which is acid fast. Gram positive, gram negative, then acid fast. Acid fast are those bacteria that cannot actually be stained by the gram staining procedure. Because of difference in their cell wall composition, they require acid fast staining procedure to detect it under the microscope. And the mycobacterium is the specific group of the bacteria which is actually made as fast bacillus, while there are also some others like leucardia, which are the gram positive, and diphtheria can also be show as fastness, but very weak as fast. Otherwise, they are gram positive. Other main group, major group, is the non-free living obligate intracellular parasites, which includes two genus, Rickettsia and the Chlamydia. Both of them are responsible for causing different types of diseases, and they require host cells for their survival, for their multiplication. So these all were bacteria which have got the rigid, thickened cell wall. Now the flexible, thin-walled cell bacteria. It includes trypanema, treponema causing syphilis, and the borrelia causing Lyme disease, then the leptospira causing leptospirosis. Last group is the wall-less cell bacteria, that is the mycoplasma, which consists of the two species among which Mycoplasma pneumoniae is causing pneumonia. Again, you can see examples of the gram positive, cocci and bacilli. This is the flow chart. So you can see one arrow is showing cocci, other is bacilli. Cocci are divided into the two main groups, streptococci and staphylococci. Streptococci are divided into the two main groups, coagulase positive and the coagulase negative. Coagulase positive are the very important group, Staphylococcus aureus, while the coagulase negative includes the two bacteria, there are Staphylococcus epididymidis and the Staphylococcus lepidophyticus. While the streptococci have been divided into the different groups like beta hemolytic, alpha hemolytic, and the peptostreptococci. Peptostreptococci and the they are anaerobic organisms, while the beta hemolytic and alpha hemolytic, including the different types of bacteria, respectively, beta are consisting of Staphylococcus pyogenes, Staphylococcus aegypti, Staphylococcus enterococcus picalis, Staphylococcus bovis, while alpha hemolytic are including the Staphylococcus pneumoniae and virulent Staphylococci. They all are aerobic organisms, facultative anaerobic organisms. They require oxygen to grow, but they can also grow in the absence of the oxygen by fermentative procedure. But peptostreptococci always need absence of the oxygen to grow. Other group is the bacilli. It is consisting of, as I have already told you, bacillus, genus, and the Clostridium, both are spore-forming. Bacillus is aerobic and the Clostridium is anaerobic group, while Cornibacterium, Listeria, Ectomyces, they are non-spore-forming and they are non-flammatous. But they are flammatous and non-flammatous. Cornibacterium and Listeria are non-flammatous, while the Ectomyces and one another is there, the Xenocardia, they are flammatous, gram-positive rod. Here, again, the flow chart of the gram-negative. Gram-negative, you can see again Pope signed the vessel. There is a repetition in this flowchart. Already I have told you about these organisms, but because these are very important to retain in the mind. So repetition is because I want there should be a revision and you should retain them, these things in your mind forever. The cocci and the vessels. Again, the cocci are Neisseria meningococci or meningitidis, Neisseria gonorrhoeae and Neisseria gonococci. They are also differentiated from each other from the vessels of the right hemisphere. Well, the vessels are those which are affecting enteric actually colon, and there are and primarily they are actually affecting the colon and then the other parts of the body, while other group is the non-enteric, where they are affecting other parts of the body, but secondly they are also going to affect in the colon. So but they are actually non-enteric mostly. Then there's the respiratory. Hemophilus, Bordetella, Legionella, all they are respiratory organisms, mostly causing diseases of the respiratory tract. Animal source, bacteria, gram-negative rods, which are Brucella, Francisella, Pasteurella, and Giardia. Animal source, bacteria are also known as the zoonotic organ bacteria. Actually, source of infection here is the animal. That's why they are known as zoonotic organisms. Enteric are those which affect primarily or secondarily colon. Non-enteric are those which produces pathogenesis outside the colon. Respiratory are those which are affecting respiratory system. Gram-negative cocci, I told you, are this area, but there are some rods which are known as coccobacilli because they are not cocci, but they are short rods with the convex borders on the both sides. So they are looking coccobacilli. Right. So they are actually Haemophilus influenzae. They know, and then the Bordetella pertussis and the Brucella species are also included in this group. Means other actually zoonotic organisms are also included in this group. They are bacilli, I told you in the previous slide, but they are coccobacilli mostly. Legionella pneumophila is a gram, also gram negative rod, and it is a coccobacilli. It requires charcoal yeast together with iron and cysteine for its growth. Needs a special medium. Well, H. is also needing X and the VR. You can retain and the five factors for their growth. Bordetella, these bordet jangu medium for their growth, and they are oxidase positive. So they are actually aerobic organisms. Brucella species are also aerobic. Here I told cocci, you can see this area, meningitis are glucose positive and maltose positive. While that, this area, gonorrhea are only glucose positive, but they are maltose negative. On the basis of maltose, so this is a sugar and the biochemical test is done, they are classified in the, they are actually subdivided and differentiated from each other. One more thing is there's a capsule formation. So the Neisseria meningococci are capsulated while Neisseria gonococci are not capsulated. Gram-negative bacteria can also be subdivided or distinguished on the basis of the biochemical test. First of all, Enterobacteriaceae group is there, which is lactose fermenter and non-lactose fermenter, including group, and these bacilli are known as LF and the non-NLF, the lecture summation and the lecture summation. Lecture summation include the two groups, slow summation and the fast summation. Fast summation include the gradually and the E. coli and enterobacter. As you can see, there is a urease positive and the indole positive has been added because these are both other biochemical tests on the basis of which they are distinguished from each other. Klebsiella are always urease positive, but E. coli are always indole positive. But enterobacter is not indole positive, urease positive. While the slow fermenter, Citrobacter and Serratia, the other, they are fermented with waste, so they need more time to ferment the lactose. But still, they are lactose fermented. While other group is the lactose non-fermented, non-lactose fermented. So they are distinguished on the basis of the other biochemical reactions like oxidase reaction and the requirement for the oxygen. So first group is the oxidase positive, including Vibrio cholera and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a strict arrow and oxidase positive Vibrio cholera, they are able to ferment glucose. They are glucose positive, but Pseudomonas is not. While oxidase negative group includes a number of the organisms, where they are distinguished from each other on the basis of the urease biochemical test. Some are urease positive, some are urease negative. For example, urease positive include the Proteus marbulus and the Helicobacter pylori. Helicobacter pylori needs Campylobacter medium for their growth. While the Proteus, they are showing swarming growth on the Mycorrhiza medium, so they can be distinguished from each other on the basis of swarming property. While urease negative include the Yersinia pestis, they are detected on the bipolar staining process, and Yersinia enterolytica, they are motile at the 25 degree centigrade and otherwise non-motile. For Campylobacter jejuni, it grows on the Campylobacter like the Helicobacter pylori, but they are US negative while Helicobacter pylori are US positive. So on the basis of US, they are distinguished from each other. Then Shigella dysentery, they are non-motile. Salmonella species are motile and produce hydrogen sulfide, and thereby they can be distinguished from the other urease negative organisms. So these are different gram-negative bacilli which are distinguished from each other on the basis of the different biochemical reaction. Whenever there is a suspicion for any gram-negative organism, we have to go through all these tests on the basis of which we can actually confirm the diagnosis. Here you can see gram staining may have the bacteria looking like. I want to tell you, have seen the practical, I'm sure. So you must know the gram, the red color bacilli are cocci, both of the pink color are gram negative organisms because they are unable to retain the primary crystal violet dye inside their cell wall. So they become pink when they are counter-stained with the secondary dye, that is serpentine. This is responsible for giving them pink color. While during the gram staining procedures, the gram-positive organisms remain violet color because they retain the crystal violet dye inside them because the presence of the peptidoglycan. So when the modified iodine is used, they form a complex with the crystal violet, and this complex is retained inside the gram-positive cell wall because of the presence of the peptidoglycan, which is thick multilayered in the gram-positive organism. But the gram-negative are having only thin layer of the peptidoglycan, so they cannot retain it. You can see gram-positive Rod as well as the cooks at the are of the purple color. And the spiral curved rods which are showing the vibrio shaped rods are there also. Cooks are also there. Again, you see here classification of the bacteria on the basis of shapes. This is also morphology. Morphology includes shape as well as the arrangement of the organisms. So you can see cocci are in the different arrangement. Monococci having only single coccus, diplococci are having pairs, and then the diplococci encapsulated, because diplococci are mostly encapsulated and are only the streptococcus pneumoniae. Then you can see the streptococci are arranged in the cluster, while streptococci are arranged in the chain. Sarcina are having eight bacteria in group, while the tetrid are having four. The other group is of the bacilli. There you can see coccobacillus and the bacillus. What is the difference between them? The H. influenza are coccobacillus, Bordetella is coccobacillus, and they are like this, coccobacillus. While the bacilli like Shigella, E. coli, they are state rods, and you can see how the state rods are seen. They are diplobacilli. This is a pair of the cocci. They are arranged in the palisadic arrangement. You can see palisades, and then in the chain, they are streptococci. Again, you can see there is a budding in the appendage bacteria. They are looking like hyphae and the stars. So, gram positive actinomyces rods are looking like hyphae, but they are not fungi. Fungi are found in the form of the hyphae and the spores in the form of buds. So, here you can see the hyphae of the actinomyces mostly. Here on the right side, you can see in large rods, Physobacterium, Vibrio has the curved, common form are there also with the flagella, they are mostly Helicobacter, club rods, Cornibacterium, while helical forms are of the Helicobacter pylori, and cork is two forms of the Borrelia, Burgdorferi. Spirochetes are the syphilis causing agents, Treponema, Pallidum, and then the filamentous. Which organisms are filamentous? Mostly Actinomyces and Leucarchia. And non-filamentous are Diphtheria and Listeria. And I wanted to show you the mycoplasma, which is ball-less. They have no cell wall. They are pleomorphic, different shape hoga. Definitive shape nahi ho sakta ki ball cell wall nahi hai. They are penicillin sensitive or resistant. They are mostly penicillin resistant because they don't have any wall. Penicillin have effect on the cell wall. Smallest free living organisms are their microscopic side egg colonies. Then Mycoplasma pneumoniae is the example. Again, biochemical test. What they cannot ferment. Is this for bacteria? So if they ferment lactose, yes, then the different group. If yes, no, then the different group. Those which are not fermenting, they use citric acid as their sole carbon source. So the citric acid positive are the Shigella, Salmonella group, while the citric negative are the Shigella, which again produces lysine G carboxylase. While the Salmonella group generally produces H2SG. Sorry. While the those which are fermenting letters, they are actually also using citric acid as their sole carbon source. So those which are citric acid positive, they are again divided into the two groups on the basis of the acid-to-acid test. Those which are not citric acid positive, they are Escherichia. While those are positive, they are again of the two types, citrobacter and the enterobacter. Enterobacter are acid-to-acid positive, while citrobacter are acid-to-acid negative. Now, on the basis of the motility, some bacteria are motile, some are negative, not motile, mostly because of the presence of flagella. Non-motile organisms which lack flagella are usually going to form a single line of the growth when they are tested for motility. They does not spread into the surrounding area, only the strip where the organisms are present, it is the growth is shown. While a motile bacterium will grow and make a healthy zone around the strip line. So the examples of the motile are the Salmonella, Vibrio-Coli, Pseudomonas. And the examples of the non-motile include Staphylococcus and the Shigella. Now the basis are the ability to produce pathogens. Those organisms which are able to spread disease and can cause disease are known as pathogens. Those which cannot cause disease, for example, Lactobacilli, they are known as non-pathogenic. While those which can actually cause pathogenicity when they get opportunity. Normally non-pathogenic bacteria are actually non-pathogenic, but when sometimes they show the disease, actually it is because of some lacking in the host. For example, there will be this immunity impaired. There can be some other reason, like the antibiotic intake for a long period can suppress the one group of the normal flora of the that part of the particular part of the body, where the other normal flora gets opportunity to multiply and grow and space to increase their number, and then they become pathogenic and cause the pathogenicity. Now, on the basis of the oxygen, I have already told you there are some organisms which are aerobic, some are obligate anaerobes, some are facultative anaerobes. And then there's also one more group, that is microaerophilic. Aerobic are those which grow in the ambient temperature, which contains 21% oxygen and a small amount of the carbon dioxide, about 0.03%. Obligate anaerobes are those which strictly require oxygen for their growth. For example, Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Other group is that which is actually microaerophilic bacilli, and they grow under the reduced oxygen level, 5-10%, and increased carbon dioxide concentrations about 10-10%. Compiler vector jejuni, the helicobacter pylori, are the examples of the microaerophilic group. Facultative anaerobes are those bacteria which are capable of growing either in the presence or in the absence of the oxygen, because they can ferment glucose and then they can get energy, ATP for the cell. Obligate anaerobes, for example, Clostridium, they actually do not need oxygen at all. Caprophilic require increased concentrations of the carbon dioxide, that is 5-10. Caprophilic organisms are the chimpanzee and cerebellum. Require actually energy. They get this energy by the carbon dioxide. Another group is aerotolerant. pH is also important for some bacteria. Extrophiles are there, which are lactobacillus, and then alkaliphiles, those which require alkaline pH. Neutrophiles actually need 6 to 8 pH, while the alkaliphiles need less than 6, less than 7, 6, or 6 pH, while the extrophiles always require more than 8 pH. Majority of the medically important bacteria grow best at the neutral or the slightly alkaline pH. Rickettsia and Chlamydia, I told you about the intracellular, non-free living intracellular organisms. Gram-negative obligate intracellular parasites are the two types, Rickettsia and Pseudomonas. So, they require animal or human being, living a host, to get their energy and to survive. Now, normal human microbiome. So that is the normal flora of the human being. Normally, a large number of the bacteria are present on our body, inside or outside the body. The normal flora are the microorganisms, actually, which live on another living organism. It can be human being, can be any other animal, or inanimate objects without causing disease. We are covered with the we are covered with 8 cultivar within our intestine, approximately 100 trillion bacteria, which form the normal flora of our body. So this normal flora is made by a large number of the bacteria present inside or outside the human or the animal body. Normal human microbiome, it's important that the normal flora may antagonize other bacteria through the production of substances which inhibit or kill non-indigenous species. Other thing is the disadvantages. Actually, they can cause disease in the individual. When individuals become immunocompromised, when they change the usual anatomic location. Now this slide is showing a chart in which members of the normal flora are present along with their anatomic locations. Bacteria species are present in the colon, throat and vagina. Candida indicates in the mouth, colon and vagina. Clostridia species in the colon. Cronibacterium species and these are present in the nasopharynx, skin and vagina. So similarly, other are also present in their specific area. And they are causing pathogenicity also accordingly. Where they are present, they will cause pathogenicity of that version. Location in the skin, the important organism is Staphylococcus epidermidis. But there are some other organisms also which are less important but are there, including Staphylococcus aureus, Cronibacterium, Diphtheria and the various Staphylococci, Pseudomonas, Aeruginosa, and aerobes like Propionibacterium, and then the yeast, the Candida albicans. Then, note that there are Staphylococcus aureus. Skin may Staphylococcus epidermidis, nose may Staphylococcus aureus. Legs are the important organisms, while less important, skin may Staphylococcus aureus and other organisms, while in the case of the nose, less important are Staphylococcus epidermidis, the Colibacterium, the thyroid, and also various Staphylococcus are present over there. Mouth. Here the important organism is Grignard's Staphylococci, while the various Staphylococci in the Echinococcus cordans are the less important organism. Dental plaque, mass Staphylococcus pneumoniae, and the less important include the P. butella, intermediate Porphyromonas gingivalis. They are present in the mouth, but especially in the gingival devices, various anaerobes, bacteroids, bacterium, Streptococci, and Actinomycetes are present. But in the throat, only the virulent Streptococcus is present, which is important. While the less important include the various Streptococci, including Streptococcus genus, pneumonia, Neisseria species, Haemophilus. These are the important three species which should be present in the throat, but in the less important way. Colon contains the bacteroid flagellus, the Escherichia coli, as the main member of the normal food. In the large number, they are present for this. While other Eubacterium, Physobacterium, Bifidobacterium, all others are less common and less important. In colon, bacteroid flagellus and the Escherichia coli are there, while others are less important in the also with the Enterococcus faecalis, Physobacterium, Lactobacillus. In the vagina, Lactobacillus, E. coli, and the group B, Staphylococci are present. With that, a great importance. So they are important organisms over here. Various Staphylococci, various gram-negative are present in the less importantly the vagina. The urethra shows no important organisms, but less important organisms are there. Actually, there's the Staphylococcus epidermidis, Colibacterium, diphtheria, and the various Staphylococci, various gram-negative rods, and also E. coli. Here you can see the different areas. Important members of normal flora, mouth, nose, throat, high microbial density is found over here. Nose, Staphylococcus aureus, Staphylococcus epidermidis, oropharynx, regions. Teeth are the gingiva containing plaque, caries, biofilm, Staphylococcus aureus, and also present, for example, bacteria. Skin cutaneous surface may Staphylococcus aureus is not here, but Staphylococcus epidermidis is in the last number. While Colibacterium are also present in the skin, yeast and Candida. Human flora are the microorganisms which constantly inhabit the human body, as I already told you. They are present in the body. They include bacteria, fungi, all with them. Some of these organisms are known to perform tasks that are useful for humans, while the majority have no known beneficial or harmful effects. Those which are expected to be present And then, under normal circumstances, do not cause disease. Turns normal flora microbes. So this is the end of the lecture.